Chapter 2. I didn't do it on purpose, obviously. Kill Jared Richards, I mean. Miss Everlyn said I shouldn't say that, that I killed Jared, because it was an accident. What happened, and that wasn't the same thing at all, but accident or not, Jared Richards died, and I was the reason. So what was the difference? Either way, I killed him. I hit the hockey puck at a bad angle. That was what happened. We were out playing on Cedar Lake last February. February 12th, if you're counting. But who is? I'd heard that some of the guys needed another player to make it even, so I'd asked if I could join them. I wasn't the best skater, but everyone knew I was a pretty good athlete all around. So they said sure. Funny thing was, when it started, I thought it was going to be a really good day. Anyway, I hit the hockey puck at a bad angle, and Jared was standing where he shouldn't have been standing, and it got him, whack, right in the chest. Which probably wouldn't have been so bad. I mean, I got him hard. It would have hurt anybody, but it shouldn't have killed him. But it turned out Jared had a bad heart, a defect. That's what they said. No one knew about it before. Only found out when it was too late. One bad shot, that's all it took. One bad shot and one bad heart. So, can you blame me if I drew pictures sometimes? If my thoughts were full of Jared? One thing was for sure. If Jared Richards really had fallen off a tightrope, instead of getting whacked in the chest by yours truly, no one would even have to ask if I wanted to join their pickup games. Anyway, I was thinking about all that and about Jeremiah and Noah in the park too on the way to dinner with Dad and Carrie on Friday night, which is probably a bad idea because it was making me hot mad all over again. And at dinners with Dad and Carrie, it was best to start cold as ice because that was the only way to get through it. It wasn't going to be a good evening, that's all I'm saying. You all right, little brother? Aaron asked me as we turned the last corner before the diner. I could see his eyes in the rearview mirror, worried and sympathetic. Doug had called dibs on the front seat, and normally I would have Indian burned him into giving it up, because they, technically, as second oldest, I had permanent dibs. But I wasn't in the mood, so I let him have it. I'm fine, I told Aaron. Ever since Aaron got his license last year, he'd suddenly started acting like he was the dad in the family, which was ridiculous because he was only 4 years older than me and 6 years older than Doug. And anyway, the last thing any of us needed was another dad. We pulled in the parking lot of the St. Albans Diner just after Dad and Carrie, apparently, because Dad was busy helping Carrie out of the car. It looked about as easy as leading a beached whale back to water. What if she was has the baby at dinner? Doug asked, whipping off his seatbelt and turning around to talk to me with his knees up on the seat. What if we have to help her deliver it in a taxi cab? Why would we get in a taxi if Dad has his car right here? I asked. She's not even due for 3 weeks, Aaron told Doug. Get your feet off my seat. These aren't my feet, Doug said. These are my knees, see? Knees! Aaron sighed a big fatherly sigh. Let's go inside, okay? You think if Carrie did have her baby right now, we'd still make it home in time to watch the game? I asked. Aaron rolled his eyes at me in the rearview mirror as he pushed his door open. What? I said. We're playing the Diamondbacks tonight, and I want to see it. The Dodgers have been on a losing streak for the past week, but their top pitcher was making his first start after coming off the disabled list, so they were going to turn it around for sure. Let's go. Hey, Dad greeted us when we beat him to the door. Carrie walked pretty slow these days, on account of the baby. You're on time. Good to see you, Carrie said, which was not very convincing. I was surprised she'd come tonight, to be honest. She skipped out on dinner most nights to give us more male bonding time. Aaron and I buried our heads in our menus as soon as we sat down, even though both of us got the same thing pretty much every time we came. Doug got to work scrunching up his straw wrapper from his water glass and dropping water on top of it. On top to turn it into a wrapper worm. Dad checked his phone, and Carrie pretended to admire the curtains. Aaron squinched up close to me in the booth and whispered, 3, 2, 1. So how's school? Carrie asked. I fist-bumped Aaron under the table. He had Carrie down. It's still summer, Doug answered, engrossed in soaking the table with water. School doesn't start till Monday. Oh, Carrie said. Right, I knew that. She laughed a trilly little laugh. Pregnancy brain. Wait, you're pregnant? I asked in my most incredulous voice. Under the table, Aaron kicked me. Trent, please, Dad said, setting his phone on the table. Must we? Doug finished with his wrapper worm, and Carrie handed him a wad of napkins to mop up his mess. We got our second favorite waitress, Claudia, who clearly had a thing for Erin, even though she was probably in her 20s. "You are all ready?" she asked us. She gave Erin a little smile. No one else. We were all ready. No matter how good a restaurant it is, if you go there for dinner 3 nights a week for a full year, you're going to get a little sick of it. And the St. Albans Diner wasn't very good to begin with. When Mom and Dad first got divorced, back when I was 5, Dad used to drive us to Cedar Haven every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday night to have dinner with us there. Sometimes he'd eat dinner at the house with us and Mom, which was weird, but sort of nice too. But usually we'd go to one of the restaurants in town. He'd take us to the arcade after, or out to a movie even, if there was something we could all agree on. But after Erin got his license, Dad decided he was sick of the hour drive each way, so we met in the middle. And the only thing in between Cedar Haven and Timber Trace, where Dad lived, was the St. Albans Diner. So that's where we went. "How's the, Erin started after Claudia left to put in our order. I could tell he was searching for something to talk about. I wasn't sure why he bothered. "The construction going?" "Oh, we finished that weeks ago," Carrie said. She sipped at her tea, decaf, for the baby and smiled at us. "The room looks just darling. Pink walls and carpet, too. We'll show you next time you're out." "Can't wait," I said. "Trent," Dad warned. What I should have said was that it was news to me that the remodel had been done for weeks. The whole reason we'd been skipping our every other weekend overnight visits lately was that Carrie thought the construction would disturb us. I guess now that it was over, she still thought we were disturbed. "Your father's company picnic is coming up soon," Carrie told us. The smile stretched too wide across her face. She rubbed her belly. "We'll see if this one holds out a little longer so we can all make it. I hope so. It was so much fun last year, wasn't it? Egg race champs?" She aimed her smile first at me, then Dad. "Yeah," Dad said. "It was." And for a second thought, he was about to smile or something. But I must have been making it up, because Dad never smiled at me. Anyway, he went right back to looking at his phone, so I'd definitely been making it up. Last fall, at Dad's company picnic that we were forced to attend every year because Dad wanted to convince all his coworkers that he had his big, loving family to brag about or whatever, Carrie got the bright idea that it would be super fun if Dad and I entered one of the races together, which is how the two of us ended up with our legs tied together by a purple handkerchief, our hands gripped tight around the handle of a plastic spoon balancing an egg. For the three-legged egg race, which was somebody somewhere's idea of a good time. Anyway, turns out we won, because apparently we're both pretty good and not splatting raw eggs into the grass. We got a trophy and everything. Dad kept it on the bookshelf in his and Carrie's living room. To be honest, it wasn't the worst time I've ever had in my life, winning that race with Dad. But even last fall, being joined at the lake to my father by a handkerchief wasn't exactly on my top 10 list of things to do with myself. And now, it definitely wasn't. We were all quiet for a while after that, waiting for our food. Dad started answering a message. Doug went to unscrewing the lids of the salt and pepper shakers, which he obviously was not supposed to do, but no one stopped him. "Me and Annie and Rebecca are going to make cookies tomorrow," Doug told no one in particular, "with Annie's old lady friend, Mrs. Finch. She makes good cookies." "That's nice," Dad said, still checking his phone. "You've been spending a lot of time with those girls lately," Carrie said, smiling that stretched-out smile of hers. "Yeah," Doug said. He looked like he was thinking about something for a second, but then he shook his head in return. His face focused to the salt and pepper shakers. "They're nice." I didn't know why Doug had to suddenly start spending all his time with two girls, especially those two girls. Rebecca was fine, whatever. Her dad, Dr. Young, was our family doctor. But Annie Richards, was Jared Richards' little sister. And for the life of me, I couldn't figure out why Doug felt it was necessary to become her best friend in the entire world. He'd been friends with her in daycare, back when it made sense to be friends with whoever happened to sit next to you during snack time on the first day, and then they'd sort of grown apart, which made sense, too. But in the last few months, Doug had been acting like it was his personal mission to spend every waking second with her. Back in July, he'd even turned our entire front yard into an obstacle course that he built just for her, made mostly out of pool noodles that he'd stole from Erin's lifeguarding job. I mean, it's not like I thought they sat around talking about how I killed her older brother or anything. But what did they talk about? I just didn't get why they had to be friends, that's all. "Doug, don't mess with the salt," I told him, once I figured out what he was doing. pouring a thin layer of pepper into the top of the shaker so you'd reach for salt but get pepper on your fries instead. You're going to get us kicked out. You're not the boss of me, Doug snapped back. I'll show you who's the boss of you, I told him, making a fist across the table. Boys, settle down, Dad barked at us. Can't we have dinner here, dinner where you don't fight? But Doug's trying to prank people, I argued. I didn't know why I bothered. Everyone knew that Dad's favorite kids went Aaron, Doug, me. And I was only on the list because you had to put all your sons on there somewhere. And you hate pranks. Doug did a lousy job of screwing the lid back on the salt shaker, and then he slid it across the table back where it went next to the ketchup. You ruined all my best pranks, he pouted at me. You don't have any best pranks, I told him. Seriously, Doug was the world's worst pranker. Aaron was good, and I wasn't too shabby either, but Doug never managed to pull anything off without botching it somehow. Last week, Aaron had pulled his best prank ever, which was covering the toilet bowl with saran wrap, so that when Doug went to pee, the stream went everywhere, and Doug thought he'd gone crazy. It was pretty funny until Mom had a supreme fit and said that if she was going to live in a house full of animals for the next several years, they were at least going to be hygienic animals. And if we ever pulled another prank again, she was going to string us by our toenails and leave us for the coyotes. I was pretty sure she'd do it too. So, no more pranks ever, for as long as we lived. That was Mom's new rule. That had pretty much always been Dad's rule. So, Dad said, and then cleared his throat next to me. Aaron, 3, 2, 1 at me again. And sure enough, the next thing out of Dad's mouth was, what did you all get up to today? I gave Aaron a second fist bump. Aaron told Dad and Carrie about his day at Swim Beach, where nothing happened at all because lifeguarding was about the most boring job you could have, apparently. Doug told them about riding bikes and playing Monopoly with his two new best friends ever. And when Dad remembered he had a third son and asked me about my day, I said nothing. Because what was I supposed to talk about? How I drew a bunch more pictures of the kid I killed and didn't play baseball, and a girl with a scar thought I owed her one. Do you think our food's going to come soon, I asked. I want to get home in time for the first pitch. Trent, be civil, Dad said. We're having a nice dinner. Just saying, I told him. I felt my chest warming up again. Not quite fire, but on its way, and I wasn't sure why. I scooched lower in my seat and crossed my arms in front of me. I could feel my book of thoughts pressing against my stomach from the front pocket of my sweatshirt. Why hadn't I felt that idiotic thing at home? It's the Diamondbacks tonight, and I want to watch it. We'll be done when we're done, Dad said. Just enjoy your dinner, all right? Some kids don't spend any time with their fathers. Some kids are lucky, I muttered. Well, the table got quiet then, let me tell you. What did you say to me? Dad asked. He was all squinty eyes and anger. Nothing, I said. Fire, hot fire in my chest. You listen to me, young man, Dad started. Aaron and Doug were staring down at their placemats. They were smarter than me when it came to Dad, always had been. I go out of my way 3 nights a week to make sure I have a healthy relationship with you boys, and you cannot be more ungrateful. I just want to have a pleasant dinner with my three sons. Is that too much to ask? I did not look up at him. Trent, just do me a favor and don't say anything for the next 5 minutes. You think you can do that? That's when Claudia brought our food. I might have been making things up, but it seemed like she put my burger in front of me extremely gently. There you go, sweetie, she told me. Your father had a hard day at work today, Carrie decided to say as she dug into her salad. Dad rolled his eyes but didn't say anything. I picked up my burger and stared at it. All I said was I wanted to watch the Diamondbacks, I told him. For the love of, Dad shouted, slamming his fork down on his plate. Trent, just shut up for 5 minutes, would you? You don't tell me to shut up, I shouted back. The fire was prickly now, in my neck, my ears, my everything. You're my dad. Dads can't say shut up. My heart felt like it was beating my stomach. Pound, 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 right up against my notebook. Thoughts thumping everywhere. Stop shouting, Trent. You're causing a scene. You're the one causing a scene, I told Dad. You stop shouting. Under the table, Aaron was squeezing my leg, trying to calm me down, I guess, but it wasn't working. It never worked with Dad. Doug was devouring his pancakes, pretending like he was deaf. Carrie looked like she wished she could have the baby right then and there and end the whole argument. Dad glared at me for a long time with his angry father face. I was pretty sure he'd invent it just to use on me. Aaron and Doug never got the benefit from it. Well, you're not going to watch that game tonight, that's for sure, he said at last, and he looked like he was real proud of himself for coming up with something so clever. I gave him my angry son face right back. Oh, yeah? I asked him. Trent, quit it, Aaron hissed at me. Yeah, Dad said. Interesting, I said. And just like that, I set my burger back down on my plate, not even one bite taken out of it, wiped my fingers clean on my napkin, and slid myself out of the booth. Just where do you think you're going, Dad asked me. I didn't ask. Kept on walking. Walked right out of the diner, the bell on the door clanging behind me. I heard the bell clang again when the door reopened. It was already on the far end of the parking lot by that time. Took him long enough to get out of his seat. Trent, Dad hollered at me. I picked up my pace. Trent Zimmerman, you get your ass in here this minute. I'll be fine, I shouted over my shoulder, still walking. Don't you worry about me. I've got a game to catch. I thought he'd run after me then, grab me by the shoulder, maybe make me stop, but he didn't. I'd been walking for a good 10 minutes before someone finally caught up to me. I was walking down the highway, clenching and unclenching my fists to try to walk, work some of the fire out of them, thinking what a moron I was and wishing I had Aaron's cell phone at least so I could call my mom and make her come pick me up, because it was a long white walk to Cedar Haven, and no way was I turning around now. My book of thoughts thumped against my stomach inside my sweatshirt with every step. Thump, thump, thump. Those stupid thoughts. I couldn't stop thinking, pelting me the whole way. Thump, thump. Trent! I heard my name before I heard the tires rolling across the pavement behind me. Trent! It wasn't my dad. Leave me alone, I told Aaron as he pulled up beside me and slowed to a near stop. Cars whizzed around him down the road, honking as they passed. I'm fine. You gonna walk home, idiot? Aaron asked me. It's 25 miles. Doug was in the passenger seat beside him. Get in the car, Trent. What else was I supposed to do? I got in the car. You're a real jackass, you know that? Aaron told me as he checked his mirrors and pulled back onto the road. Then he reached behind his seat and handed me a styrofoam box. I opened it. My hamburger. Thanks, I said. Aaron said nothing. For once, Doug was quiet, too. The Dodgers lost to the Diamondbacks that night, 13-2. A real pummeling.